Good morning and welcome. Today we celebrate the Mass for the third and second Sunday in ordinary time. Our procession this morning. Friend of God, please rise.
Thank you. things that are yours. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Enter into a sanctuary made by hands, a copy of the true one, but foundation of the world. But now, once for all, he has appeared at the end of the ages to take away sin by his sacrifice. Just as it is appointed that human beings die once, and after this the judgment, so also Christ, offered once to take away the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to take away sin, but to bring salvation to those who eagerly await him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
When I was in seminary, we had to do what was called an apostolic year. And that's a year off from formal studies to go into full-time pastoral ministry. And the idea was to get us out of the classroom, get us away from the books, and in contact with people so that we could learn how to minister. And also, we could learn about the gifts of the community. I was a small-town boy, and I had never been outside of the United States ever, except for crossing over from one afternoon in Windsor. Doesn't really count. And so I asked to be placed at our mission in Tanzania, which is in East Africa. And so I spent a year there, and I learned a lot. The people there in Tanzania live in what we would consider poverty. Some of them, you know, they weren't as poor as others, but if they were privileged enough to own their own houses, quite often it would just be two rooms. Their meals were extremely simple. Sometimes it was just rice and beans. I knew of families where the parents ate every other day to make sure that their kids had something to eat every day. every single day. And if the children were lucky enough to go to school, that also was iffy. There are no free schools in Tanzania, at least there weren't back in 2001. And so if a child went to school, he or she had to pay tuition. And one medical expense within the family could compromise that. No more tuition, and therefore, no more school. It certainly put things into perspective for me. But what struck me the most of my year in Tanzania was the generosity of the people. They really looked out for each other, and they took care of each other. They shared what little they had. And when I was invited to somebody's to be a guest in somebody's home, that was a very humbling experience, because when you're a guest, it means they offer you the very best that they have. So if they have one chicken, they prepare that chicken for the guests. And if there are leftovers, then the kids get the leftovers. I learned that it was considered rude to turn down an invitation to someone's home, and it was also rude not to eat what they offered. So I learned to eat just a little bit and then claim I was full. The people of Tanzania were so generous with each other, with guests, and they were very generous with the church. Sunday Mass, the offering of the gifts took 10, 15, sometimes 20 minutes, because they would bring the gifts up and pass a basket, and it would be a dance. They'd be playing music and the people would dance up and just go on forever. And they would not only bring with them money, but they would bring with them soap and rice and beans and other things that could be shared for the poor. And of course, that might mean they themselves would go without. They were like the widow in today's gospel. They gave what little they had, and they gave it to God, and they gave it to the poor. And as I said, that was a real lesson for me. When I came back, it took a lot to process that year. In fact, I think it took me several years to really begin to understand what I had experienced there. But there are a couple of things I learned there that I would like to share with you. And first of all, I learned when I came back, I felt such guilt. First time I went into a supermarket, I felt so guilty looking at everything that was there. You know, and I've shared this in the past, I don't know if I've shared it here, but one of the things that made me the sickest in my life was at the airport when I was leaving Tanzania. And you know, you go to the airport and there are just people swarming around you begging for money. You know, and you get through that, and you finally get in, and we got on the plane, British Airways. We hadn't even left the tarmac, and the stewardess was explaining to us how each one of us had our very own flat screen TV to watch our favorite programs on the long flight home. We know, because Jesus says, we know that God is going to judge the nations. How will he judge us? Sorry, I got off track. But anyway, it's a process that I learned here in the United States that we can still give everything, even if we're not living like people in sub-Saharan Africa. It would be very irresponsible for us to give away our retirement and then have to live off of other people. You know, but to be generous, to share what we have with the poor, even if it makes sacrifices, it can feel very good sometimes to feel the pain of sacrifice because of what we've given to others. And many people here certainly know that by what they give. You know, when we fast, why is it we fast? Is it to discipline our bodies and our minds? You know, certainly that's part of it. But it's also to live with less so that we can learn how to be generous with others. I also realized when I came back from Tanzania that up until I went there, I didn't really understand how much we were part of a global community. I'd heard that expression. If you asked me to be part of a global community, I would have said yes. I didn't really know what that meant. You know, but I knew that the rest of the world had problems of its own, but I was a citizen of the United States, and that usually was my focus. And I didn't feel terribly responsible for things that happened outside of the United States. And yet, we are responsible. Part of a global community. So much of the wars in this world occur because some nations put themselves first, sometimes even to the point of making it a slogan, and they're not concerned about others. It's not a sign of weakness for a country to make sacrifices for the well-being of others. Certainly when it comes to global warming, or the climate change is what we call it, we're responsible for that, and we've got to make some changes. And when we do that, it strengthens us, and it brings us closer to what the gospel Jesus Christ is all about. This month, we're also celebrating National Black Catholic History Month, And many people are wearing these wonderful t-shirts as a way of celebrating that. And as we reflect on how we are called to give all, you know, one of the figures on that t-shirt is Augustus Tolton. And so let's take a look at Augustus for a moment. I know most people will already know his story. He was born into slavery here in Missouri to the Elliott family. He and his family were held by the Elliots. And Augustus later stated that during the Civil War, his father was able to slip across the Mississippi and join the Union troops and fight in the Civil War. And eventually, his mother was able to smuggle herself and her children over into Illinois. And Augustus, as a child, was allowed to attend the local parish school during the months when he wasn't working in the tobacco family, even though the pastor faced a lot of pressure from white parishioners not to allow him to attend. He later felt the call to priesthood, and he was rejected by every seminary here in the United States to study for priesthood. And so he went to Rome, where, of course, in Rome, diversity is celebrated. You're not afraid of each other just because there are different races. That's what Rome is all about, is its universality. So he studied for the priesthood there, was ordained, came back to Illinois. For a time, he tried to establish a parish in Quincy. He ran into opposition both from white Catholic immigrants and also some of the black Protestant leadership because they didn't want their people to be converted to the Catholic faith. And so ultimately, he went to Chicago, where, as we know, he founded St. Monica's Parish, which became a national model of African-American Catholicism during that time. But how often in Augustus Tolton's life did he have to give all to God, including resentment, pain, hurt that he felt from his fellow believers and brothers and sisters in Christ? On the t-shirt, there's a beautiful quote from him. "The day I was ordained, I felt so strong. No hardship would be too great for me to accept. I was ready for anything." That is a man who knew how to give all to God, as each one of these figures on the t-shirts do the same. And that's what we're called to do, to give all, to hold nothing back. That's going to look different for a married couple than it is for a single person. It's going to look differently for a person with a terminal illness than it does for a person who's young and healthy. But to serve God, we have to seriously reflect on what does it mean concretely to give all to God in the here and now for me. And the widow in today's gospel and the saints that we celebrate have something to say about that. So as we continue with this liturgy, we pray that we can learn to trust God every part of our lives, our past, our present, and our future, so that we can place everything in His hands, holding nothing back. And speaking of holding nothing back, this coming Thursday we also celebrate Veterans Day, that day when they recognize all of those men and women who offered their lives to service for their country, knowing what it might cost. They sacrificed a lot, and they will tell you so did their families. And so we owe them a debt of gratitude. And we have so many parishioners here that have served. And so as your name is called, could you please stand so that we can recognize you and also offer a blessing.
Andrew Thompson, Specialist, 4th Class, U.S. Army. Bernadette Stapleton, Specialist, 4th Class, U.S. Army. Beverly Mercy Smith, Staff Sergeant, U.S. Army, retired. Deacon Charles Allen, Sergeant, U.S. Air Force. Charles Bradley, Specialist, 4th Class, U.S. Army. David Harris, Staff Sergeant, U.S. Army. Dominic Garland, Specialist, 4th Class, U.S. Army. Deron Smith Sr., Sergeant, U.S. Army, retired. Terry Willis, Specialist, 4th Class, U.S. Army. Valerie Howard, Airman, 1st Class, U.S. Air Force. Carl Johnson, Specialist, E-4, U.S. Army. Byron Willis, Sergeant, U.S. Air Force. Edward Hughes Jr., Sergeant, U.S. Air Force.
So if we could all please raise our hands to bless these people. Loving God, we give you thanks for the generous service of our parish's veterans. We are grateful for the freedom we enjoy because they were willing to be part of our nation's defense. We ask you to bless the work of their hands, that we may always use our freedom wisely and work together for universal peace and harmony between nations and peoples. We ask you to bless these veterans, that they may always know our gratitude and your deep love for each one of them and their families. And we ask this in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, veterans.
Christ our Lord.
Amen.
acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Look with favor, we pray, O Lord, on the sacrificial gifts offered here, and celebrating in mystery the passion of your Son, we may honor him with loving devotion through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them all to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For when your children were scattered far by sin, through the blood of your Son and the power of the Spirit, you gathered them again to yourself, that a people formed as one by the unity of the Trinity, made the body of Christ in the temple of the Holy Spirit, might, to the praise of your manifold wisdom, be manifest as the Church. And so in company with the choirs of angels we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate
apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession and presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your glorious church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Mitchell, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you, and your compassion, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever. By the pouring forth of your Spirit, the grace of integrity may endure, and those your heavenly power has entered. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for a moment. So one thing this past Thursday, the Archdiocese came in to film our choir singing. You can see why they chose this choir. A couple of major events today celebrating Black Catholic history. Both of those events are posted on our website. The first is Black Catholic History Celebrating Our Ancestors. And that I sent out the link a couple days ago. Also, it's sponsored by the Office for Racial Harmony and also St. Pius V. And so it's online. The whole thing is online from 3 to 4:30 today. But you need to register, so just go click the thing I put up on the website, and then you can register and get the Zoom link. And then the other, we've been announcing already, that's the 1917 East St. Louis Race War, which is 12 o'clock today at the Rock Church. And as I mentioned last week, there's a 90-minute video that is on the web. You can click on our website and take a look at the video. You're supposed to watch that in advance, but there's not much time left. That's okay. And then covenant cards. The covenant cards, of those cards that we receive from parishioners, we have increased our annual income by $5,500 a year. That's really, really good. And also, and this is really great, of our monthly income from the collections, we are just under $1,000 short a month of paying for our expenses out of what we bring in on Sunday. That doesn't sound good, but that's actually very good. Because most parishes can't pay all the bills just from the Sunday collection. We got a grant just a couple weeks ago for $10,000. That covers 10 of the 12 months. So we're doing pretty well financially. We're breaking even, and that's what we're doing. Thank you. And the Finance Committee has a meeting right after Mass today. And that's in the room downstairs across from the Environment Committee workroom. You got an email this week about Joyce Spicer. Mother Eleanor Henderson passed away, and so the funeral is this coming Wednesday at Sacred Heart Church in Florissant. It's 9 o'clock visitation, 10 o'clock funeral, Sacred Heart in Florissant for Eleanor Henderson, mother of Joyce Spicer. Just a couple other announcements. Winter's coming, and based on our experience last year where the steps over here got almost eaten away by the salt, it took Ron a very long time to basically rebuild the steps. So this year, as we get snow and ice, on those Sundays where there is snow and ice, this entrance will be closed. We'll actually rope off and put cones there so people don't come up the steps. That way we're going to be able to preserve those steps and not have to repair them so much in the spring. After 10:30 Mass today, speaking, Ron and the maintenance committee could use some help moving all of the chairs over to that corner right after Mass today, because there's going to be a lot of replastering done, so we need that workspace. Also after Mass today, there's a ladies' guild meeting that's in room A for anyone who would like to attend. Thanksgiving is just around the corner. We'll have our 9 a.m. Thanksgiving Day Mass here at the church. And then this is the first Sunday of the month. So are there any birthdays this month? Any November birthdays? Happy birthday! Are there any anniversaries? Wedding anniversaries?
I keep telling people I'm 87, I don't know why. They suggested that I have an endoscopy. And the results of that endoscopy showed that I had a tumor in my esophagus. And so subsequently, I had another endoscopy with an ultrasound that showed that the tumor is cancerous, it's malignant, but they also saw a couple of, what do they call those things?
Polyps,
yes, yes. So I'm going to be going on radiation for about 5 weeks, starting, I don't know when yet. I'm going to see those doctors tomorrow. I also will receive what they say is mild chemotherapy. So the whole, if depending on how that comes out, I may have to have surgery in about 6 weeks. So I just wanted to ask you all to, I wanted to let you know that if by any chance I'm not able to come to church, that's why I let it be part of it. I have a faith, and I told you about it. I said, I'm a person of faith, and I believe that everything is going to turn out all right. But I just want you all to please pray for me. Pray for me that everything does come out okay. I also received a word from my sister yesterday that one of my nieces is having some serious problems, I guess with the colon, I think she said cholesterol, something with the colon. But please keep her name is Mary Ruiz, and just please keep her in your prayers too. Matter of fact, keep all my family in your prayers. I'm the baby. So, and I'm 76, so I mean 78, wow, so 87. It's just a number. But I want